Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Paul Jay, coming to you from the Perry Institute in Amherst, Massachusetts. Bernie Sanders has promised in his election campaign free college education for everybody in state and public colleges. And how's he going to pay for all this? He says a transaction tax on Wall Street. Essentially, every time somebody buys and sells a stock, they would pay some kind of a tax. And obviously, this would affect high-speed traders and great big funds that do move tons of money in and out of the stock market, far more than it would affect individual buyers and sellers who don't do this all day long. Now joining us to talk about how real is this tax, how practical, is it doable, and could it really pay for free college for everybody, is Robert Pollin. Thanks for joining us, Bob.
Thank you very much for having me, Paul.
So Bob is the co-director of the Perry Institute. He's the author of Greening the Global Economy, a new book, and he's told me it's very important. Okay, I'm teasing Bob because we've known a long time, but in fact it is very important, and that's if it wasn't, we wouldn't be doing a whole series about it. So we're going to talk about the transaction tax.
Okay.
So the knock on the transaction tax is that there really isn't that much money there unless it's more significant. If the amount of the tax is significant, it's going to be passed on into the public anyway, because the people that control these things will find a way that it doesn't come out of their profits. Talk us through the whole logic of it.
The idea of the transaction tax is very simple. It is a sales tax. It's like if you go down the street and buy bubble gum, you're going to pay 6% or whatever it is in your particular municipality or state. This is the equivalent in that every time there is a trade enacted for stocks, for bonds, or for derivatives. So you mentioned stocks, but actually, as the tax that I designed that Senator Sanders has picked up, it includes all trading.
And the Sanders campaign is making use of the research you did. It's actually a plan you helped develop.
Well, it was a bill that I helped to write for Congressman Keith Ellison called the Inclusive Prosperity Act. It was introduced 3 or 4 years ago. And Senator Sanders has adopted it. He's calling it the Robin Hood tax. He introduced it as a Senate bill. So it's the same thing. The tax rates are exactly the same.
Which are?
So the tax rates are on stocks, 0.5% of the value of a trade. So if we're talking about $100 in trade, we're talking about 50 cents tax on the $100 trade. On bonds, we're talking about 0.1%. So on a $100 trade, we're talking about 10 cents. And then on derivatives, we're talking about 0.05% of a tax, of a percent. So that if we're talking about a $100 trade on like a credit default swap or an option, the tax rate is gonna be 0.5%.
So how do you get to these numbers? And it would seem to me it would be in the public interest to have a way higher tax on derivatives, given how much trouble derivatives trading has given us. So how do you arrive at this, and why so low on derivatives?
The reason it's so low on derivatives is because we are scaling the derivative tax to the so-called notional value of a derivative instrument, and I'll explain what I mean. So that a derivative, like an option to buy a government bond next year. The government bond is worth $1,000. But you're not buying the government bond itself with a derivative. You're buying the right to buy the government bond. And generally speaking, the research shows that the underlying value of a $1,000 government bond is going to be about 3% of that bond. So that's why we scale the tax rate on derivatives to be much lower, to reflect the fact, to make it easy to measure, because we're saying, okay, it's a $1,000 option. So we're scaling the bond to the $1,000, but we're lowering the rate because you're not really buying a bond. You're not buying the bond, you're buying the right.
Does that apply for, you know, if you're speculating on
yes
movies or corn or oil?
If you're speculating on the movements of any kind of asset, you don't actually own the asset. You own the right to buy the asset or to sell the asset. So that's why it's scaled much lower. And in fact, the critical thing when you measure these things is we want to know how much it actually costs to transact business in the first place, and that what we're doing with the tax is adding to these so-called transaction costs already.
So I guess part of the argument Wall Street would make against this is we're already paying tax. If we're doing this personally, we pay income tax, we pay capital gains. If it's corporate, you pay corporate tax.
Right.
Why should we get taxed on top of all that?
Well, for one thing, I mean, you and I, everyone pays income tax. We pay sales tax when we go to buy things at stores or over the internet. And in this case, all financial market transactions are at present untaxed. So yes, there are other taxes, but this is a tax that would apply to trading in the same way that other kinds of trading. Other countries have the tax.
Who?
Well, to start off, Great Britain has had a financial transaction tax for a long time. China has a transaction tax. France now has a transaction tax. Italy has a transaction tax. Other countries have had them at different times. There's a discussion now at the level of the entire European Union to establish a transaction tax, at least among 11 countries that are interested in, including Germany.
So the Sanders plan is not so radical. There's lots of capitalist countries. This is not some big socialist maneuver here.
No, I mean the tax. You asked me about the tax rates. So the 1.5% rate that I've proposed Sanders has picked up, is exactly the rate that is now operative in Great Britain and has been for a long time.
And how much money do you think this generates?
Well, if we add up the three taxes and if we look at the level of trading in the United States today, my estimate is that it's in the range of $300 billion a year after we assume that trading falls by 50%. Now, that's implausibly large decline in trade. And to say that there's going to be a 50% contraction in all.
Why should there be any contraction?
Because you're imposing a tax.
Yeah, but it's pretty small. I mean, it's not.
Well, it's not small relative.
Even on big trades.
It's not small relative to the level that they're paying on. I mean, I think it's appropriate level of added cost. But the key thing is to know how much they're already paying on transactions costs. So if we look at the transactions costs and we say, okay, we're adding 10, 15, 20% to transactions costs. So that's not negligible.
How could you be adding that much? Well, the numbers you gave were not in the range of 20%.
They are, actually, because we're not talking about the total. You're not, when we buy a bond for $100 or $1,000, I'm not talking about the $1,000 purchase. I'm talking about how much you have to pay a broker, how much you have to pay in fees, and that's what we're talking about with respect to transaction costs.
I mean, one of the things in terms of reducing the amount of trades is that high-frequency traders operate within such small margins, and they make money because they use enormous trades.
Right.
You might see less high-frequency trade, but a lot of people think that wouldn't be so bad.
So the idea of the transaction tax was actually initially proposed. It was proposed by John Maynard Keynes in the 30s, picked up by James Tobin in the 1970s, a Nobel Prize winning economist. And their real focus was precisely to reduce speculative trading, not generate revenue. They knew it would generate revenue. When you tax, you generate revenue. But they were, first of all, concerned with reducing speculative trading. So how much would speculative trading fall? It will fall. Will it fall enough to prevent, something like a crisis like we had in 2008? No, I don't think it will. It's not designed to achieve that, and it's not the best way. It'll contribute to reducing speculation, but not enough. I think high frequency trading, because every time you do it, tax. It will discourage, super high frequency trading.
Which most people, including many regulators, think would be a good thing, because you get these wild swings sometimes because of high frequency.
Yeah, no, it will reduce it.
What's the big knock against this? I mean, it seems pretty straightforward.
The knock against it is
we don't want to pay a tax.
Rich people don't want to pay taxes.
Oh no! What are the
We would never want to do that. But on top, the other thing is if we take the argument that, you know, Wall Street is making very important positive contributions towards channeling money to productive investments in the economy that create jobs, then the argument is, well, you're discouraging that and you are distorting the work that Wall Street does by establishing this tax that, you know, otherwise they wouldn't be thinking about this tax and they can make decisions based on which companies deserve to get money. That would
and
be
not the, likely they would put it into free college education.
No, that would not be, you know, where the money would be going.
Not very likely.
Yeah. And I mean, the more fundamental point is, look, there's almost no evidence showing that, you know, Wall Street trading has a positive impact on productive investment activity. It's quite the opposite. It encourages short-termism. It encourages firms to worry more about their stock price than doing things to promote productive activity. So that argument against the tax, I think, is not valid.
All right, thanks very much for joining
us. Okay, thanks.
And thank you for joining us on the Real News Network.